The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh boy, I'm here. Oh no, oh boy. Here we are. Welcome to a Thursday. I am Nicole Sandler, as always, coming to you live at NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network, among some other wonderful stations like Netroots Radio and Air Progressive and FYI Nation. But today, we are not on YouTube because literally, moments ago, YouTube took me down. They took me down not over anything I played today or yesterday or this week. They took me down over something that I played in 2017. I don't even know what it was, but I'll have to deal with it after the show. So hopefully our regular YouTubers will find us at NicoleSandler.com/listen-live or on Facebook Live. The Facebook Live is at The Nicole Sandler Show. Or, you know, hey, it's radio, so you can just listen on radio as it's meant to be. Oh, boy. Oh, yeah. So we start off the show with some breaking news, as usual, and it's not good news. Again, Florida. Oh, my goodness. The U.S. Supreme Court today. I know you thought the term is over, right? Well, it technically is, but the Supreme Court today declined to weigh in on a federal appeals court's decision to temporarily block some Florida felons' eligibility to participate in elections. Yeah, this really sucks. Here's the background on it. Back in November of 2018, we here in Florida passed a constitutional amendment. It was Amendment 4, which allowed convicted felons who complete, quote, all terms of sentence, the right to vote. It passed with nearly 65% of the vote, exceeding the 60% threshold requirement. So it looked like a done deal. You serve your time. You've paid your debt to society. You get your right to vote back. But we elected at the same time this moron, Ron DeSantis, to be governor for some reason, at least, well, some people did. And so what happened is Amendment 4 went into effect in January 2019. And then the Republican-led Florida legislature passed, and this idiot Republican Governor Ron DeSantis signed a bill that clarified, quote, all terms of sentence to include legal financial obligations such as fines, fees, and restitutions. So I'm reading to you from an article at CNN that says, the fees and fines that felons are ordered to pay are wide-ranging but significantly high for an individual leaving prison, especially if they're unemployed. They can range from a couple of hundreds to tens of thousands of dollars. This according to Lisa Foster, the co-director of the Fines and Fees Justice Center, a group that aims to eliminate fees in the U.S. justice system. And in here in Florida, all the court charges that are unpaid after 90 days are referred to private debt collectors who are allowed to add up to a 40% surcharge on the unpaid court debt. And that is unconscionable. That's just disgusting. In addition to it being a poll tax, you can't climb out from under that kind of debt. If you're just released from prison and you've got these debts hanging over you that you can't afford to pay, and you don't have a job when you get out of jail, they can keep, these collection agencies can keep just piling on the extra fees, and you never climb out from under it. So we voted, more than 65% of people voted to restore the voting rights of felons who've served their time, and now these fucking Republicans have succeeded in probably making it so that they can't vote this November. Then again, It's back to another story. It's unclear whether the lower court will issue a final ruling in the matter in time for the November presidential election. The U.S. Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit in Atlanta has scheduled a hearing on the issue for August 18th. That's the day of Florida's primary election. Yeah. So, you know, it's fucked up. Shit's fucked up. God, if I wasn't in a bad enough mood before, thanks, YouTube. Oh, my goodness. Anyway, I do like to start the show with a funny. And yesterday, I told you about a video I had seen, except I didn't have it. Now I've got it queued up. Just when you can't watch the video. Again, you can come over to Facebook Live. I thought we'd put it out on Periscope as well, but somehow my Periscope thing got unhooked up, and I didn't have time when I realized that YouTube took me down to get it going again, but we'll get something going in time for tomorrow, I'm sure. Oh, shit, we're doing this George Rodriguez tribute show on Saturday. I got to work to get my YouTube rights back again. Just what I don't need today. Anyway, this video that I'm going to share with you, or the audio, because that's really all you need, is from two guys that do these videos under the moniker of Chad Goes Deep. It's actually two guys, Chad and JT. I did try to email Chad and JT to see if they might want to talk to us about this video, but I have not heard back from them yet. Anyway, with that being said, no response from them. So with that being said, let's just hear what they had to say. Here's the premise for those of you not seeing the video. There are two guys in Southern California. Now, the other day I told you about Orange County, California, it's that no man's land between Los Angeles County and San Diego County. And we used to jokingly refer to it as being behind the orange curtain. And that's even before we knew that we'd have this orange menace in the White House. But what we do know is that Orange County is pretty backwards, pretty Republican. I hate to overgeneralize, but for the most part, you know, it is. And well, so these two guys, Chad and JT, went out to Huntington Beach with a box full of masks, and they were offering free masks for anyone who needs them. There's your premise. All right, guys, take it away. It's Chad Goes Deep on the Nicole Sandler Show.
What's up, dudes? We're here in Huntington Beach to solve the mask shortage. As you can see, no one here has a mask, but we brought our own supply to fix the problem.
Guys, we've got a cure for the mask shortage. We've got masks. If anyone needs a mask, we've got them. You don't need one?
Yeah, you might.
Why not?
I don't know if anybody has ever explained to you that breathing your own carbon monoxide is not healthy.
I heard about that, but I heard about this other thing.
Called coronavirus?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, but I'm not afraid.
Nice.
I know where I'm going when I die. You guys?
I don't know.
The sky?
Hopefully to a pokey shop.
No, where do you go?
Going out. Oh, you don't want to go to hell, do you?
No, that suck.
Yeah. You know, the mask tells me I'm supposed to be doing something.
Right.
If I'm out here, nobody's going to tell me to wear a mask.
Right. For sure.
If we had a cooler design, would that make a difference?
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, later, dudes. Yeah, be well. Sir, do you need a mask?
No, I'm good. Thanks for asking.
Cool.
Let me ask you this, truthfully. You get smoking weed?
Excuse me, my man. We're giving away free masks.
He's smart. He's socially distancing. Sorry, sir.
Dude, what kind of sunscreen do you use?
Just like a Walmart brand.
Oh, nice.
I just use like the 50 spray. You know?
Dude, you got such an even base.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I've been out a lot. You know, when you get laid off from work, you got time to hang out at the beach.
Dude, same here. Yeah. We can only give you a mask if you wear it on the beach. We
should. I can't do it. I'm walking 20 miles, man. It ain't gonna work.
That's a long walk, dude. Congrats.
You can't wear a mask if you walk?
I don't know. Maybe it obscures vision.
Oh, you need salt water because of this shit. If you're breathing salt water, it's healthy.
Oh, dude, I'm gonna put salt on everything now.
No, sea salt. Sea salt. Other salt, you can get fucking, it can kill you.
What's your cause?
Nudists for masks.
Seriously?
Yeah, we're nudists.
Right on.
A little bit of action there.
I hang out on a couple nude beaches myself.
Oh, right on, dude. Oh, yeah. Drop a little dong there, yeah.
Is that what you guys call it?
Dropping dong.
Dropping dong.
Yeah.
Right on.
Do you need a mask?
No, thank you.
Why not?
Because I live here.
What do you mean? Hey, do you guys need a mask?
No, we don't. Why?
You don't?
Because there's this thing called coronavirus.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's a bullshit lie.
Really?
Yeah, dude. I know. Go fuck yourself.
Who made up the lie?
Hey, go fuck yourself.
What?
You heard me.
He's pissed.
I love passion.
Yeah, me too. What up, Pinky?
You need masks?
No.
All right, see you later.
Do you guys have masks?
No.
You guys are just going around willy-nilly with no masks?
Yeah.
If I give you these masks, are you guys gonna wear them?
Sure.
You swear on it?
Yes.
On Tyler, the creator?
Yes, sir.
All right, dude.
Whoa, wow. All right, see you guys.
Yeah, have a good day.
Later.
Dude, everyone here is so cool. You're hanging out masks if you want.
Oh, I have masks in my bag.
Thank you.
Why aren't you guys wearing them?
Because we left them in our cars.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
So.
No, I'm good, thanks.
Damn it.
Are you pro-mask, bro?
Do you want a mask?
It's all fake, dude. Come on.
I'm good, man.
Nah, man. That's just that's a fraud,
bro. I like freedom, dog.
I like fresh air. Just shut down the fucking country? That's bullshit,
yeah,
man.
I'm good.
But does wearing a mask shut down the country?
When you close down half the economy, yeah.
Yeah,
I think so.
But can't we open it up quicker if we all wear masks?
Nah, dude, that's a talking point on the TV, bro. He says it's not a mask, it's a muzzle.
What?
It's a muzzle, not a mask.
What does that mean?
Yeah, what does that mean?
What?
The muzzle.
Do you know what a muzzle is?
No.
Who's got you guys?
Oh, good question.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't even know.
Just a benevolent, superseding intelligence.
Hey, what's up, Rick?
So fucking cool.
Dude, Rick is the coolest, dude.
What up, dude? Do you wear a mask?
God does love me.
Do you wear a mask? What?
I think he's
coming back. Come here. Do you need a mask?
Come here.
Get ready to run.
What else you want?
Just to give masks.
No, look, you're not making my fucking rights and not my rights, first of all.
We're just trying to hand out.
I don't give a fuck what you're trying to do. You believe in a mask? I don't.
That's cool.
Fucking leave it alone. We're just. If you want some of me, come on and get this.
No, we're not trying to fight anyone. We just want to hand out masks.
Yeah, do you want the mask? Maybe we do a happy hour at Sharky's later.
Don't be an asshole.
Well, we learned a valuable lesson today.
Don't hand out masks when you're wearing sandals, dude. If you're going to hand out masks, wear shoes you can fight in. Or run.
Oh my goodness. Or run. So those were two guys on Huntington Beach in Orange County, California. So for anybody who thinks that California is all, you know, fruits and nuts and hippies and no, that's Orange County. And you may as well be in, you know, Fresno or the Inland Empire or a lot of California where those kind of people live. It is just unbelievable. And yet the numbers of people infected keeps growing. We'll take a very quick break and come back on the other side and give you the news, because there's a lot of news going on. So bear with me, please. I was thrown for a loop just literally minutes before going on the air. So trying to get my bearings again. We are streaming on Facebook Live. And, of course, audio streaming, because it's radio, on the Nicole Sandler Show at NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network. All right. So while we are in commercials over there, I thought we would take a time out here as well and, listen to something from our pal Boca, Brittany Summers.
Every day, all around the world, energy is being produced to power our lives. While energy development comes with some certain risks, like flammable tap water, North America's natural gas producers are committed to safely and responsibly earn a healthy profit and enrich ourselves. We'll attempt to win you over with this simplified cartoon and heavily edited copy that says filling instead of drilling thousands of feet below freshwater sources. This cartoon shows a harmless tube penetrating the Earth's surface. We like to think it's your ass. The harmless gas is then stored within self-contained well systems that blemish the landscape and are placed in your backyard. And using state-of-the-art monitoring technologies, wait, the copy runs off here. Rigorous lobbying efforts help us ensure our operations will continue to provide safe and clean explosions for our communities and kitchens. We're America's natural gas. Kiss our ass.
I'm Rick Smith, and this is Labor History in Two. On this day in labor history, the year was 1934. That was the day fatalities on Bloody Thursday touched off a four-day general strike in San Francisco. It was the first time a general strike had shut down a major U.S. port city. The strike had been raging since May. Workers battled with police days earlier as the shipping bosses tried to force open the docks that saw two workers killed. More than 40,000 poured into Market Street to march silently in their funeral procession. Outrage fueled plans for a general strike. 21 unions across the city voted to walk. In his book Strike, Jeremy Brecker notes the momentum for a general strike was unstoppable, despite attempts by AFL leaders to prevent it. By 8 a.m. on this day, the San Francisco general strike had begun. Over 150,000 workers, including Teamsters and butchers, restaurant and transit workers, joined longshoremen and seafarers in shutting down the ports, the city, and the highways. But as Brecker points out, the strike was met with a powerful counterattack. Hundreds of special deputies were sworn in. The National Guard was called out, complete with infantry, machine guns, tanks, and artillery units. State officials were poised on the edge of declaring martial law. Vigilante raids began on the 17th with assaults on the Marine Workers Industrial Union and the offices of the Western Worker newspaper and strike bulletin. Many other gathering places and homes where workers regularly met were also busted up. Hundreds were rounded up, beaten, and arrested. The city's Central Labor Committee authorized exceptions that eroded the strike's power. In the face of the violent raids and opposition from AFL leaders, the General Strike Committee voted to end the strike. Labor History in Two, brought to you by the Illinois Labor History Society and The Rick Smith Show.
And now, back to Nicole on Progressive Voices and NicoleSandler.com.
All right. Well, we've got a lot of news to get to today. And, of course, it's Thursday, so Howie Klein will be along in just a little while. But now, let's tell you what's happening in the world. Whoops. Oh, that was the wrong news sounder, but okay, it'll work. So, as cases surge, the total number of COVID-19 infections in the United States has now passed 3.5 million. With more than 137,000 deaths. The outbreak has gotten worse in 41 states over the last 2 weeks. Now, public health groups are sounding the alarms about a White House effort to bypass the Centers for Disease Control as the federal recipient of state and local COVID-19 case data. The administration says a change to put the Department of Health and Human Services in charge will streamline reporting. But the experts say the shift could harm the quality of U.S. information and is designed to assert control by higher ups at a time when Trump has been downplaying the severity of the coronavirus crisis. And sure enough, there was this tweet this morning from Charles Ornstein of ProPublica. It read, "I had hoped it was a glitch, but no, the CDC hospital capacity dashboard has gone dark. The CDC director has said they still have access to the data, but apparently, the public no longer does." Lovely. Just lovely. This, as this administration is politicizing everything about this pandemic. Just everything. Dr. Anthony Fauci, of course, the nation's top infectious disease expert, said in an interview that was published by The Atlantic yesterday, and it was only, he did this interview with The Atlantic because he is prevented from going on television. But in this interview with The Atlantic yesterday, he said, well, he didn't understand why White House officials have tried to discredit him recently. In fact, wait a minute, I've got audio of him. Here's what he said on The Atlantic webcast. It's doing this again. It did this yesterday too, didn't it? Wow. I'm beside myself. Oh, I know what it is. I was playing the wrong thing. Here we go.
It doesn't matter who you are or what you are. You're Republican, Democrat, anybody else. We're all in this together, I believe, for the most part. You can trust respected medical authorities. You know, I believe I'm one of them, so I think you can trust me.
I think so.
But I would stick with respected medical authorities who have a track record
you think?
Of telling the truth, but it's entirely understandable how the public can get mixed messages and then get a bit confused
you think?
About what they should do.
Wonder who he's talking
obviously
about.
The more you test, the more you're going to pick up. So increase in testing is going to give you increases, but there is no doubt that there are more infections. And we know that because the percentage of cases, of the cases that are tested that are positive, is increasing.
Yes. It's got nothing to do with what Trump said, which is just so fucking asinine that I can't hear this clip enough. I know we all hate hearing his voice, but keep in mind the man who is, for some inexplicable reason, the president of the United States actually said this.
If we didn't do testing, instead of testing over 40 million people, if we did half the testing, we'd have half the cases. If we did another, you cut that in half, we'd have yet again half of that.
No, that's not how this works. That's not how any of this works. Somebody slap that man and tell him to get a fucking clue. Can you imagine if any other president ever said something as asinine as that? I have to go in tomorrow for a CAT scan because I'm coming up on my 4-year anniversary of my surgery for lung cancer. So if I went by Donald Trump's logic, I shouldn't have the test, because if I have it, there's a chance it could show some recurrence of the cancer. If I don't have it, I won't get it. So, you know, by that logic, we can cure the world. Just stop all the testing. Don't get any tests and nobody gets sick. How does this man get away with this shit and he's not stopped dead in his tracks? Now, you know, the last time he held a briefing of the coronavirus task force was the day he told us to inject disinfectant and maybe shove a UV light up our asses to kill the virus. How is this man still standing? How is he still in office? I'm sorry. I just don't get it. I talk about opposite world all the time, but this is the dictionary definition of opposite world.
Everything you thought you knew, you never knew it all. Sideways is straight ahead. Facts no longer matter. Reality is now fiction. There's a signpost up ahead. Your next stop, opposite world.
You think? Well, we're there. And, okay, so, but wait, there's more. These stories from the Republican governor's idiocy files. The governor of Oklahoma is a man named Kevin Stitt. He announced yesterday that he is the first governor in the country to test positive for the coronavirus. Hey, I know, we got something for him. Whoops, that's the wrong, I hit the wrong button. We got something for him.
We're number one, damn it!
Yeah, Stitt said he was feeling fine, but got tested Tuesday because he was feeling a little bit achy. Well, which is it, Stitt? Were you feeling fine or were you feeling achy? But he didn't have a fever anyway. Stitt, who opposes a statewide mask requirement, not only encouraged Trump's Nuremberg rally there in Tulsa in June against the advice of all the state's public health officials, but he attended the rally without a mask. And now he has the Vronavirus. And, well, you know, hey, Oklahoma is not alone. Let's go to Georgia, where their idiotic governor, Brian Kemp, yesterday banned local governments in the state from requiring residents to wear masks in public. That voided orders in at least 15 cities and counties. This is just amazing. Kemp has said that he thinks wearing masks to fight the spread of the coronavirus should be voluntary and that local governments don't have the authority to order people to wear face coverings. Meanwhile, COVID-19 hospitalizations in Georgia have nearly doubled since the beginning of the month to 2,800, the most on record. These people just don't learn. Oh. All right, wait, there's more. Well, we told you yesterday, Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg was discharged from Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore, is now at home and doing well. Thank you very much. That's good news. You know, I may have been taken down from YouTube today, but we were all knocked off of Twitter yesterday. That is, all of us who had the little blue check next to our names. It was a bad day for Twitter. The accounts of Joe Biden, Bill Gates, Elon Musk, Warren Buffett, Jeff Bezos, former President Barack Obama, and other prominent people were hacked yesterday in what was arguably the biggest security breach in Twitter's history. The attackers took over accounts and posted tweets that, well, were definitely a Bitcoin scam. And this is concerning because so many world leaders use Twitter and some idiots like Trump use it to announce major policy decisions. So, yeah, all seems normal today. But this, you know, Twitter, Jack, you better get on that. Oh, and one other thing. It wasn't photoshopped. We saw the picture that Ivanka posted the other day of her holding up a can of Goya black beans like a spokesmodel. Well, Trump yesterday, and I thought this was photoshopped, but it wasn't. It's the real deal. Posted a picture of himself sitting behind the Resolute desk in the Oval Office with a variety of Goya products around him and the stupid shit-eating grin. The shameless promotion of the food company obviously came just a day after Ivanka did the same thing. Both photos were in reaction to a boycott against Goya that began after its CEO said that the country is truly blessed to be under Trump's leadership. By the way, both of these pictures are in direct violation of the Hatch Act, and they should be prosecuted. But, you know, we are living in a banana republic and we have a corrupt Justice Department who doesn't believe in holding the president accountable to the rule of law. We are in some really, really scary times. All right. We'll take one more quick time out and come back on the other side with Howie Klein because, you know, it's Thursday. So someone start mixing up those dirty Debbies. OK. All right. So for everyone still here, hopefully Progressive Voices is in spots. For everyone still here, we'll take a quick time out as well. I will get to the point where I will keep content going while PV is in spots, but I'm not there right now. So thanks for bearing with me. We'll be right back.
These are the sounds of crushed souls. The sounds of despair from former radio personalities languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to reestablishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio, and you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?
Why does Donald Trump refuse to wear a coronavirus mask?
Good question.
Because he realizes that, in a mask, we'd all recognize him as the robber who has been moving furtively behind the scenes of the pandemic to rig the rules against workaday folks to further enrich corporate elites. With media attention riveted on COVID-19 body counts, Trump and company have felt free to monkey wrench labor laws, dynamite environmental regulations, manipulate the tax code, and generally burglarize our people's commitment to the common good. They're like Robin Hood and his merry band, only in reverse, stealing from the many to give more to the rich few. They've even quietly filched the bulk of the government's multi-trillion dollar pandemic recovery program, thus dramatically increasing wealth inequality. While you might have received a one-time $1,200 relief check from Washington, major corporations have actually been given the keys to the Federal Reserve's money-printing machine, funneling a long-term giveaway of hundreds of billions of dollars to them. Also, corporate interests are pocketing untold amounts from several little reported grant programs and tax breaks discreetly created just for them. For example, mysteriously tucked into Trump's first rescue package was a $135 billion tax boondoggle specifically designed for such hucksters as giant real estate developers. Like whom? Well, Trump himself and son-in-law Jared Kushner appear to qualify. Just lucky, I guess. Adding to the peculiarity, this handout had nothing to do with helping America recover economically from the pandemic. Rather, it provides retroactive tax breaks on deals developers cut long before this year's COVID crash. This is Jim Hightower saying, it's Trump and Company's version of the old political adage, never let a big crisis go to waste.
To get more of Jim Hightower's populist take on what Wall Street and Washington are up to, visit www.hightowerlowdown.org.
Are you a multinational corporation hungry for a treat? Well, come on down to Schmucky Chucky's, where you'll personally be seated by Chuck Schumer himself.
So many dishes and they're all fresh.
You're gonna love our Blue Dog special, the Dino Burger, because we say so.
A good hamburger and french fries.
And every burger comes with a side order of
grits. I love grits. I love anything with corn. It's corn.
All for only $50,000. Wash it all down with a Dirty Debbie.
9/10 water, 1/10 orange juice. After a week or two, you drink this, it's 200 calories and it's acetic.
And wipe your mouth with a tissue print of Glass-Steagall. For dessert, try our DNC tarts.
Little cookies, tell the quality of that.
Most restaurants give you a mint, but at Schmucky Chucky's, you get complimentary.
Sweet and low.
Who picks up the tab for all this? Find out now with Howie Klein of DownWithTyranny.com on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Hello, Howie Klein.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm hanging in there. How are you doing?
Good. I had a little scare there. When I picked up the phone, it was the Jim Hightower
right.
thing. I didn't recognize it, and I thought it was a new intro.
Oh.
And I got all excited, and it sounded good, and then I realized no.
No, it was just him, Jim Hightower, who I love, who is still doing these great commentaries from down there in Texas, where he is, you know, quarantining still because the coronavirus is everywhere. So, Jim Hightower is one of those great, he's like a, you know, the old Timex. He keeps on ticking. We need more like him. But hey, what a segue into talking about what happened in Texas on Tuesday, huh?
Yes. And in fact, Jim Hightower endorsed Mike Siegel,
mm-hmm.
and as did Blue America, and Mike Siegel won his runoff. So he had come in first in the primary, but it was a three-way primary, and, you know, all three candidates were competitive. So it's very, very difficult to win outright. You have to get 51%, over 50% to win. And Mike came in first, like I said, but he had his runoff on Tuesday, and he won, I don't remember the exact number, but it was over 55%.
Nice.
So he did well, and that means he'll be up against Michael McCall, just a Trump ass kisser, in November.
Right. And there was another.
Texas was fairly progressive, not across the board. And in fact, the more conservative Democrat won the primary runoff in the state for the state's Senate seat. I was going to say Amy McGrath, but it's not Amy McGrath. Hegar,
right, MJ Hegar. So I don't know anything about her. In fact, I didn't know anything about either candidate. I guess people...
Igar is just the same as Amy McGrath. That's why I said it. It's, you know, fighter pilot, military hero, greatest person in the military since Abraham Washington or whatever. And, killed 10,000 Iraqis with one eye closed and one hand tied behind her back. And will go to Congress and be a very, 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 very conservative senator.
Yeah.
So, you know, and that's just right up Chuck Schumer's alley.
Oh, sure.
So she did win. She won't go to be in the Senate because she'll probably lose. And the other guy seemed like a better candidate to me. I never got to talk to him, so I don't know for sure. People who I trust said, yeah, he's better. But no one was jumping up and down and saying he was great, but better than her. But better than her isn't much.
Right. No, I hear you.
You notice, by the way, that I just saw this a few minutes ago, and it astounded me, that Move On, and I'm a member of Move On, and no one asked me to vote, but Move On just endorsed every conservative Democrat running for the Senate.
Seriously?
Like all in one shot.
Wow.
Including Frackenlooper.
Including Frackenlooper.
I mean, Move On endorsed Frackenlooper. I don't know if they know what they just did.
Well, I guess, you know, because if Frackenlooper now is the nominee, so they're endorsing Frackenlooper over Cory Gardner, which, you know, it's the old lesser of two evils thing. Unfortunately, Colorado had the chance to have a really good candidate in there in Andrew Romanoff, but they blew it.
In this case, we have real evil. I mean, Frackenlooper isn't just, you know, kind of neutral. He's beyond neutral. He's really, really bad.
Right.
So every time he does something terrible in the Senate he will win. And every time he does something terrible in the Senate for the next 6 years, I guess it's just going to be my job to inform everybody that this is what Move On did.
That's right. Yes, it will be. Howie Klein, that is certainly one of your many jobs. But, you know, that's okay. You can handle it.
Yeah.
But there was another, at least somewhat progressive woman who won a congressional primary as well. I want to say Valenzuela, right?
Yeah, Candace Valenzuela. I spoke to her early on. She seemed good. She seemed quite good. And I'm glad she won. Blue America didn't endorse her.
Uh-huh.
But she did. I hope she wins.
I hope she wins, too. Now, we saw what happened in Alabama where Trump's flunky, the former football coach, what's it, Tubville or something? Really? I mean, I'm glad that Jeff Sessions isn't in there again. But, wow, talk about a fall from grace. I mean, Jeff Sessions held that Senate seat for over 20 years. And now, and he's such a little twerp. He after he lost because Donald Trump, you know, swatted him down. I'm still endorsing him.
Yeah, although towards the end, when he realized he was going to lose because of Trump, he piped in a little bit. He didn't say the things he could have said about how terrible Trump is, but he did indicate that Trump's an asshole.
Well, there's that, you know. So Howie Klein. And then the third of the elections that were held on Tuesday was in Maine, where Susan Collins now has an official challenger. And she also was not the lesser progressive of the two.
Yeah, she wasn't. She's just a garden variety Democrat. She's not awful. She's not going to. You know what? She's going to be a little tiny bit better than Susan Collins. Susan Collins isn't the worst in the world. She's just a generic Democrat. Nothing horrible. Nothing great. Just there.
Yeah. All right.
It's not like Frackenlooper. She's certainly better than that.
Right.
Way better than Frackenlooper. So, you know, I can understand why someone might want to vote for her. And if you vote for her, you know, I mean, Bessie Sweet was the progressive person who was running, and that was the person to vote for.
Mm-hmm.
But the primary is over, and now Democrats in Maine have to decide if they want to get rid of Collins. And it's no shame to vote for, what's her name again?
I don't even remember.
Oh, yes.
Gideon, no, I want to say Gideon, but it's not Gideon.
Gideon.
Yeah. Is it Gideon?
It's no shame to vote for Sarah Gideon.
Sarah Gideon.
You know, she's not great. She's not terrible. She just is.
Right. She just is. Right. And look, Susan Collins, I'm sorry, could have done something over all these years. She could have voted against Brett Kavanaugh, but she didn't. She's always a little troubled by things. You know what? Screw that. It would serve her right to get kicked to the curb.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. No question about it. And she's going to be.
Yeah, good.
I feel absolutely certain that she's going to lose her seat.
Well, that would be nice. So then we are we're done with elections, I think, for a few weeks. We got the
No,
we're not. Oh, in my calendar, it looks like we are. I know Arizona's coming up.
Big one.
Florida's coming.
It's
what else?
Very important race.
I mean,
think about it. We have the Massachusetts race where a Kennedy family person of no import in any way except his name is challenging one of the most progressive people in the U.S. Senate, Ed Markey.
Yep.
We have, you know, a nothing, nobody, nothing, worthless piece of nothing with a good name who's challenging Markey. And then we also have aside from the Massachusetts primary, and there are a bunch of races there, including one of some real importance, which is between a mayor of a small town, guy's name is Morse, who's running against Richie Neal, kind of a conservative, corrupt Democrat ally of Pelosi's.
Yeah, Richie Neal, who is the chair of Ways and Means, who apparently held up a lot of things, like things that they could have, like in one instance where they could have apparently gotten Trump's tax records, and he held it up.
Yeah, he's a pretty bad character. You know, he tries to come across like a normal Democrat, just normal, but he's actually worse than that. But basically, you know, Pelosi doesn't want to come across really terrible, so she'll tell her committee chairs to do it for her, do the dirty work for her. But he doesn't do anything that she doesn't tell him to do.
Gotcha. Well, is there any word on if Nancy Pelosi is intent on being speaker again in the next Congress?
I think she promised she wouldn't be, but
that's what I thought.
Who knows? Also, it all hinges on, you know, commas and punctuation in her statements. I think that what she's saying, and I could be wrong here, but I think what she's saying is if Biden wins, she'll gracefully step down. And if Trump wins again, she's got to stay in and fight him. And I might be wrong about that, but I think that was the agreement that she made.
Wow. And who, well, I mean, who's waiting in the wings? Obviously, you know, Joe Crowley was, and he was defeated by AOC in 2018. Not Steny Hoyer or Jim Clyburn, please tell me.
Well, I don't think Clyburn will, but Hoyer will go for it with the idea that Clyburn would then become the majority leader. So that would be one horrible possibility. You know, two people who are, you know, on death's door and worthless.
Right.
You know, I mean, in some ways, I almost think, yeah, let it happen. We've got to kill off the Democratic Party, and this would be part of the way to kill it off. Just have Hoyer as the speaker. Instead of having Hoyer as the speaker, you could just have the head of every firm on K Street. All the chief lobbyists, they could be the speaker, and they all get to vote among themselves, and it, boom, it's done. And that would be a Hoyer speakership.
Oh, my God. Oh, God, help us, please. Well, you know, the Progressive Caucus, though, is the largest caucus in the House, isn't it? Is there any chance that Pramila Jayapal or Ro Khanna or trying to remember who the other Mark Pocan. No, Mark Pocan's in Colorado now. Who's the co-chair?
No, you got it right.
Oh, I got it right. It is Mark Pocan.
You were thinking of Jared Polis.
Oh, I'm thinking of Jared Polis. Mark Pocan. So Mark Pocan and Pramila Jayapal are the co-chairs of the Progressive Caucus in the House. Could one of them perhaps step into that role?
Well, the Progressive Caucus doesn't get anything done. They're not a unified caucus. They don't. Right. They don't do anything. Like in the case of the Blue Dogs, they all vote together. They speak as one unit. The Progressive Caucus, you know, you've got the two co-chairs who use the word Progressive Caucus, yeah, and then their members just do whatever they want to do.
Yeah.
So you can't even get the caucus is just unfocused and untogether, and I hate to say it because I like some of these people, I've been wishing for 20 years that they were better, but unfortunately they don't really get better. You know, Pramila is amazing. She could be really great. They shouldn't have co-chairs anymore.
No, it should be just her.
The one person should have a gun and shoot anybody who's doesn't agree with her. But that's not the way it is.
No.
They have to have one man and one lady. They got to have a person of color, and they got a white person. They got, you know, they could change the name from Progressive Caucus to the Identity Politics.
I was just going to say that. Yeah.
That would be just
fine. Wow. That's too bad.
I think there will be a challenge from the left. It will be ineffectual and won't get anything done, and so that'll be just a waste of time. And there'll probably be someone far to the right of Hoyer who wants to run. I expect the worst from the Democratic House caucuses, from the Democratic House conference. Always the worst.
Always
expect
of
the
course.
Worst. And you won't be disappointed.
Right. And then maybe we can be pleasantly surprised. But, that's wishful thinking probably on my part. So
we're not going to be pleasantly surprised.
No.
Believe me, we're not.
No.
You know, they might try to pass off a make-believe progressive like Hakeem Jeffries, who's and he's terrible. He's absolutely terrible. Yeah. So they might try to do that. In fact, I suspect that they will.
Yeah. They probably will. And, of course, they
I mean, you know, when you think of somebody who's actually good, who would be, like, really sort of, like, dare I say it, someone who is as good as Nancy Pelosi was when she first started in the beginning.
Yeah.
Someone like Ted Lieu, for example, Rosanna, who you mentioned.
Yeah.
That'll never happen. Mm-hmm. The DCCC has been working so hard to make sure there aren't progressives to do something like that. People don't seem to understand that. When the DCCC is in there destroying progressive candidates and electing horrible Blue Dogs and New Dems, that's what they're doing. They're making sure that the leadership will be conservative and corrupt. Corrupt means more to them than conservative. And when I say corrupt, it means, you know, business as usual, money being exchanged for votes, all the corporations, you know, being made very, very happy by the Democrats, just like they are by the Republicans. Mm-hmm. That's what they care about.
Yeah. No, I hear you. You know, it's a shame because we deserve better. And God knows we've been through enough.
We deserve better. If we deserve better, we would insist on better.
You would think. Well, we should insist. Look, I played a clip earlier today that I'm still blown away by, and it was, you know, the moron in the Rose Garden the other day. I hope you can hear this. I'll play it. But I'm still amazed that the man who is in the position of the president of the United States said these words, and he wasn't like run out of town on a rail. He said this:
if we didn't do testing, instead of testing over 40 million people, if we did half the testing, we'd have half the cases. If we did another, you cut that in half, we'd have yet again half of that.
Were you able to hear that, Howie?
Not a word.
Oh, it was Trump saying, if we didn't do the testing, we'd have half the cases. If we did, and if we cut the testing in half again, we'd have half the cases again. Seriously? He says this after he talks about injecting yourself with bleach or disinfectant? How is he still occupying the Oval Office? How has he not been 25th Amendmented out of there already?
Well, my grandfather told me, and I repeat it many times, there is one thing worse than the Democratic Party, and it's called the Republican Party.
Yeah, I guess.
That's the answer to your question.
I guess it's just astounding. It's just astounding. And they do interviews with him like he's a legitimate a political figure. He is a moron. He is a nut job. This country is being held hostage by a certifiable idiot. And people are going, oh, well, that's, you know, that's Trump. But no, I mean, we're all sitting.
What are we going to do? Pick up guns and start shooting?
No, I guess that happens on, you know, January 21st when he doesn't leave. I don't know.
They have more guns than we do. I know.
I know.
Use them before we will.
I know.
We're screwed.
We are screwed. Well, just look at what's happening now. I mean, I lost count of how many weeks you and I have been at our respective homes as each Thursday rolls around. But we're taking this pandemic seriously. I'm not ready to die yet. I don't think you are. You and I have fought those battles enough. We're fighting. And now the White House is attacking the country's chief infectious diseases expert in Anthony Fauci. I mean, I have this opposite world sounder that I played. We are in opposite world. And the funny thing is I produced that years ago, long before Trump, but we're in opposite world on steroids now.
Yeah, it's just amazing. I mean, when you look at this whole, you know, Republican response to the pandemic and you compare it to virtually anywhere in the world, it's just shocking. And Americans, I predicted in the very beginning of this that we will never get basic cooperation from the imbeciles who elected Trump until their own children and their own parents die, uh-huh. or until there are 2 million dead Americans. And that's what I said in March. In March, I told Roland that it's going to take 2 million dead Americans to get these Trumpers to ever even put a mask on.
I guess. I don't think that'll do it.
Governor,
I mean,
the governor of Oklahoma, Kevin Stitt,
uh-huh.
who you may recall a few months in March,
mm-hmm.
he sent out pictures of him and his family on Twitter at a crowded restaurant, no one wearing a mask,
yep.
saying, "Y'all come on down here, we're having a great old time." And he just announced he had
COVID.
He's got COVID.
Yeah.
And when he announced he has COVID, he also said in the same breath that he is not considering mandating masks. you probably read this week that Georgia is having its worst days ever.
Yep.
Today was, in fact, the worst day they've ever had.
Yep.
And every day is the worst day they've ever had. And
yep.
their hospitals are running out of bed space and everything yep. that could possibly go wrong that was predicted would go wrong if we don't get a control of this thing. Everything is going wrong in Georgia now. And the governor didn't only say that he will not have a statewide mandate. He said that he is negating all local mandates.
Yep.
So now he's going to be fighting court battles with local counties and local cities where they're smart enough to insist on mandates. He doesn't want any mandates, none, and nowhere in the state. So he's overriding local authorities to be able to do what? Make sure that more and more and more people die? These Republicans are out of their minds. They are crazy. Anyone who votes for a Republican for anything is just voting to slit their own throats, voting to kill their children and their family. That's what they're voting to do.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. But they're everywhere. I just saw we were kicked off of YouTube today. I got kicked off because of something I played in 2017 that I was copyright violated on today. So they took me down. I got to try to get that fixed. But so we're on Facebook Live, streaming video, and somebody just came into the feed and it's like, "You people, you were taken in by a hoax. This is all. It's the flu. It's oh my God." Go visit a hospital. I'm in South Florida. The emergency rooms, the ICU units are full. What New York experienced back in April, the rest of the country is getting now. And you want to say it's a hoax? Yeah, go walk around without a mask. Go catch the COVID and then come talk to me.
That's problem. Yes, of course, I hope they all die, every one of them. I hope they die horribly. But you don't want them to catch the COVID and come talk to you.
Because
spreading it to the bus that they take.
Yeah.
You know, they'll be spreading it everywhere. That's the problem with this thing.
Yep.
Now, on the other hand, should they follow their leader and drink bleach? Oh, I will pay. I will pay for gallons of bleach for any Republican who wants to drink bleach. I will buy it for you, any amount you want. I'll give you extra money if you drink it.
Nice.
Any Republican who wants to drink bleach, it's on me.
I'll give it to you too. You know, and then I don't watch The View, but I saw on, you know, they post clips, and apparently Meghan McCain today said she is no longer, you know, going with the cult of Fauci. It's the cult of personality. Give me a fucking break. He is a respected doctor who's worked under administrations going back, I don't know how many years, and you're going to listen.
George H.W. Bush. He started that. George H.W. Bush,
yeah.
And then Clinton, and then George W.
Yep.
Bush, and Obama, and now this imbecile.
Yep. And Meghan McCain, just go crawl back under your rock. And apparently, I saw a quote that said, I didn't have to come to work today. No, just stay home, turn off the camera, and shut your fucking mouth already. Because the only reason anybody listens to what you said is because you're a member of the Lucky Sperm Club. I'm so sick of these people spouting off who have no knowledge of anything, just like the morons who are like doubting the science and instead, you know, quoting the guy who says drink bleach and shove a UV light up your ass.
They should, please, 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 they should.
And then there's Peter Navarro. Oh, my God. So this is why he was ever given a position at the White House. Well, it's because of Trump, obviously. But then he writes this op-ed slamming Fauci, which, you know, we have sources saying that Trump was behind. And now, you know, Trump is throwing him under the bus. Oh, I didn't tell him to do that. That was wrong of him. Stop it already. I'm sorry. I get frustrated about this shit.
What happened?
No, I'm just saying I get frustrated. This whole, you know, the doublespeak from the White House over Navarro's attack on Fauci for Trump to say, that was wrong of him to do it. He encouraged it.
He ordered him.
He ordered him. Thank
Trump
you.
Ordered him to do it. And now and then threw him under the bus and said, oh, he shouldn't have done that. And the media plays this game.
I know.
So, you know, like, they don't know that this kind of thing is happening.
Right.
I mean, they, of course, they do know, but wink, wink, is he going to be punished? Someone asked that to that imbecile...
Kayleigh McEnany? The ninny.
Person.
McEnany, yeah.
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 Is he going to be punished?
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah. I got a punishment for you. It's silly to ask, but are you going to read Mary Trump's book?
You know, someone offered it to me today who has it on, you know, online and said that he could send it to me. And I said, why don't you make a couple of YouTubes and send me the YouTubes of it?
Because
it's her reading the book. It's an audio version of her reading it.
Uh-huh. Oh, but I see.
I don't know. If I had unlimited amount of time, I would read it.
Uh-huh.
But I don't. I want to read it, but I don't have the time.
No, tell me about it. Yeah, I know. I'd like to read it too, but apparently the Lincoln Project is doing readings of it that they're posting on YouTube.
What?
They have people reading excerpts and they're posting that online, so we can check that out.
I watched the first one. I liked it. I reposted it going up tonight or tomorrow or something.
Cool. Then again, keep in mind who the Lincoln Project are. I say I'll take their help, but I'm not going to invite them into my home. Just in, you know.
No, but you know who will? Joe Biden will. I guarantee you, he will be taking them very, very seriously when he's the president.
Oh, of course. And by the way, did you see who gave Joe Biden like $1 million or more? James Murdoch. One of Rupert's sons, he and his wife, James Murdoch, the son of media mogul, Rupert Murdoch and his wife, Catherine, each gave $615,000 in June to Mr. Biden's shared committee with the Democratic Party.
Wow.
Yeah, that's wow. I'm waiting for James Murdoch to, you know, take over the company and kick his dad out of there. Anyway, Howie Klein, we're out of time. Thank you as always. Find Howie, as usual, at downwithtyranny.com and kicking a few bucks to the candidates at Blue America PAC that they've endorsed. Thank you, Howie. I'll talk to you next week.
Bye, Nicole. Thanks.
Bye. And with that, we're done. Hopefully, we're going to be out before the bell. See you tomorrow, everyone. Bye.